Good morning. So, by the way, I would like to welcome you again here, Fathers of Toronto. And this is not an announcement. I am here today to give you the Word of God. Amen? Amen. So, my name is Brother Mark. Thank you. And also for the people who are watching us today on Facebook and YouTube, welcome. And we pray that someday you will be able to come here physically. Amen? Amen. I know it's you're far away from us, but you know, God is good. Amen. Okay, so I like what Sister Gemma said earlier, that it's only 20 days left before our family day, right? So that means on the 21st day, already the Burr month, right? Christmas season is coming to the Philippines. You know, the Philippines always celebrate Christmas 4 months, right? A 4 month Christmas celebration. And I hope we could do that here also without the expenses, right? Okay. So today we are going to exercise because I love exercise. I'm sure all of you want to exercise, but today it's not really a physical exercise. It's going to be reading exercise. Exercises, because there's a lot of readings today, and I love reading because we are going to read the Bible in the book of Genesis, because we're still in the book of Genesis. So today we will continue the study, and last week, if you were here, and for those people who were not here, last week, I like what Pastor Jeff's showed us. His quote title, God's Grace for a Dysfunctional Family. So if God can give grace to a dysfunctional family, imagine your family. Right? So God can give grace to all the families. Amen? Amen? Because of God's love to us. Okay. So before we start, if you have your Bible with you or Bible apps, I would like to invite you to start the exercise of reading. We will start with this Genesis chapter 27. Okay, sound check? Okay, Genesis 27. Now, it came to pass when Isaac was old and his eyes were so dim that he could not see, that he called Esau, his older son, and said to him, "My son." And he answered him, "Here I am." Then he said, "Behold now, I am old." Anybody old here? No, I don't see anybody old here. Yeah. "I do not know the day of my death. Now, therefore, please take your weapons, your quiver and your bow, to go out to the field and hunt game for me. Because Esau is a mighty hunter. And make me savory food, such as I love, and bring it to me that I may eat, that my soul may bless you before I die." So Esau is not just a good hunter, but he is also a good cook, right? Who among here, like the male, who can cook here? Can you hunt? Yeah? Okay. Okay. Next. "Now, Rebekah was listening when Isaac spoke to Esau, his son." So it's like, if you picture it, it's a tent. They're living in a tent. So Isaac is talking to Esau, and Rebekah is maybe outside listening to what the conversation is all about. "And Esau went to the field to hunt game and to bring it. So Rebekah spoke to Jacob, her son, saying," the other son, Jacob, "indeed, I heard your father speak to Esau, your brother, saying, 'Bring me game and make savory food for me, that I may eat it and bless you in the presence of the Lord before my death.' Now, before my son obey my voice according to what I command you, go now to the flock and bring me from there two choice kids of the goats, and I will make savory food from them for your father, such as he loves. Now we can see that Rebecca's favorite son is Jacob, and Isaac's favorite son is Esau. Remember, just like what Pastor Jeff said last week, be careful of favoritism. It's not really good, right? Then you shall take it to your father that he may eat it and that he may bless you before his death. So the mom and Jacob conspired because the mom's favorite is Jacob. So she wants Jacob to get that blessing from Isaac. And Jacob said to Rebecca, his mother, look, Esau, my brother, is hairy man. I think I cannot call anybody as an example who's very hairy in this. Maybe Jape, are you hairy? No, not Jape. Okay. Look, my brother is a hairy man, and I am smooth-skinned man. Oh, so maybe that's perfect for Filipino. We are okay. And I am smooth-skinned man. Perhaps my father will feel me, and I shall seem to be a deceiver to him. So he's not really comfortable to what they are going to do, right? Because he's thinking he will be a deceiver. But mommy said, it's okay. Mommy, you're my favorite son. You will get the blessing. Don't worry about it. And I shall bring a curse on myself and not a blessing. So Jacob's scared. But his mother said to him, let your curse be on me, my son. Only obey my voice and go get them for me. And he went and got them and brought them to his mother. And his mother made savory food, such as his father loved. Then Rebekah took the choice clothes of her elder son Esau, which were with her in the house, and put them on Jacob, her younger son. So we can see how Rebecca is orchestrating this plan, right? She even went to Esau's closet to get his clothes so that Isaac, who was he cannot see clearly anymore, will believe that Jacob is Esau. Do you do that also? Do you go to your brother's closet just to be, or your sister's closet to look like him or to look like her? Well, I think we are all guilty about that, right? Okay. And she put the skins of the kids of the goats on his hands and on the smooth part of his neck. So the skin of the goat, he put it here and here. Because Isaac will touch him to know that he is really Esau. He will feel the skin of Jacob. Then she gave the savory food and the bread, which she had prepared, into the hand of her son Jacob. You know, the mom prepared the food here. In chapter 25, Jacob also prepared food for his brother to get the birthright from Esau. That means both brothers can cook. So Esau is a good cook, a good hunter. Jacob is a good cook as well. And he worked from home, just like what I said that week. So he went to his father and said, my father, this is Jacob. And he said, here I am. Who are you, my son? His father, I am Esau, your firstborn. I have done just as you told me. Please arise, sit and eat my game, that your soul may bless me. But Isaac said to his son, how is that you have found it so quickly, my son? It's like he just said to Esau to hunt, because Isaac knows that when you go out in the field, it will take a little bit of time to find a good meat, a good animal. But Isaac to his son, and he said, because the Lord your God brought it to me. That's one of the lies that Jacob said to his dad. It's not really God who gave the flock, it's the mom. Oh, moms, don't do that, huh? Okay. Isaac said to Jacob, please come near that I may feel you, my son, whether you are really my son Esau or not. So Rebecca already knows that it's going to happen. So it's well orchestrated, well planned. So Jacob went near to Isaac, his father, and he felt him and said, the voice is Jacob's voice, but the hands are the hands of Esau. And he did not recognize him because his hands were hairy like his brother Esau's hands. So he blessed him. Then he said, are you really my son Esau? So they're still debating in his brain. He said, I am. Therefore, now this is the blessing. Therefore, may God give you of the dew of heaven, of the fatness of the earth, and plenty of grain and wine. Let people serve you and nations bow down to you. Be master over your brethren, and let your mother's son bow down to you. Cursed be everyone who curses you, and blessed be those who bless you. He said, bring it near to me, and I will eat of my son's game, so that my soul will bless you. So he brought it near to him, and he ate. And he brought him wine, and he drank. Then his father Isaac said to him, come near now, and kiss me, my son. And he came near and kissed him, and he smelled the smell of his clothing, and blessed him, and said, surely the smell of my son is like the smell of the field, of a field, which the Lord has blessed. Now it happened, as soon as Isaac had finished blessing Jacob, and Jacob had scarcely gone out from the presence of Isaac, his father, that Esau, his brother, came in from his hunting. He also had made savory food and brought it to his father and said to his father, let my father arise and eat of his son's game, that your soul may bless me. Remember here, we can see Esau obeyed his father, just like what his father said to him. He did everything that his father asked him to do. And his father Isaac said to him, who are you? So he said, I'm your son, your firstborn son, Esau. Then Isaac trembled, because maybe Isaac is like within the distance, right? Maybe behind the tent when he heard that. Isaac trembled exceedingly. Isaac trembled because he already gave the blessing to Jacob, which he thought it was Esau. Where is the one who hunted game and brought it to me? I ate all of it before you came, and I have blessed him. And indeed, he shall be blessed. When Esau heard the words of his father, he cried with an exceedingly great and bitter cry and said to his father, bless me also, O father. But he said, your brother came with deceit and has taken away your blessing. And Esau said, is he not rightly named Jacob? For he has supplanted me these two times. He took away my birthright, and now, look, he has taken away my blessing. And he said, have you not reserved a blessing for me? Is there another blessing? Is it only one blessing? Then Isaac answered and said to Esau, indeed, I have made him your master, and all these brethren I have given to him as servants, with grain and wine I have sustained him. What shall I do now for my son? And Esau said to his father, have you only one blessing, my father? Bless me also, father. So Esau, we can see Esau asked him twice, right? And Esau said to his father, have you only one blessing, my father? Bless me also, father. And here, he has taken away your blessing. He said, have you not reserved a blessing for me? Like, why there's only one blessing? Right? Ask yourself, why there's only one blessing? I have two sons. I have to bless both of them. But that's God's plan for them. Only one blessing for the birthright because there's only one oldest son in the family. And Esau, his father, and Esau lifted up his voice and wept. Then Isaac, his father, answered and said to him, "Behold, your dwelling shall be of the fatness of the earth, and of the dew of heaven from above. By your sword you shall live, and you shall serve your brother. And it shall come to pass, when you become restless, that you shall break his yoke from your neck." So Esau hated Jacob because of the blessing with which his father blessed him. And Esau said in his heart, "The days of mourning for my father are at hand. Then I will kill my brother Jacob." So Esau said to himself that once my father died, I'm going to kill my brother. See, the anger is it's a pill that's too big to swallow for Esau. It's hard for him because remember when in chapter 25, when Esau was so hungry, so tired, he asked his brother, "If you have any food for me." But Jacob, "Yeah, I have, but there's a condition. I will give you this lentil stew, but you have to give me by birthright." And Esau said, "I don't care about birthright. I'm hungry." See the decision that he made there? It's too harsh. Like, "I don't care of anything of the blessing. I want to eat now." He's full of emotion that made him a loser. That day, he lost his birthright to his brother. And the brother is so wise that, "Well, I can get my birthright from just a bowl of soup." And the words of Esau, her older son, were told to Rebekah. So she went, so she sent and called Jacob, her younger son, and said to him, "Surely your brother Esau comforts himself concerning you by intending to kill you." Let me ask you, whose fault is it? Is it Jacob or Rebecca? Rebecca. Oh man, Rebecca. "Now, therefore, my son, obey my voice." Now, Rebecca's dictating now. "Arise, flee to my brother Laban in Haran, and stay with him a few days until your brother's fury turns away." Until your brother's anger turns away from you and he forgets what you have done to him, then I will send and bring you from here, from there. Why should I be bereaved also of you both in one day? And Rebekah said to Isaac, "I am weary of my life because of the daughters of Hit. If Jacob takes a wife of the daughter of Hit, like this, who are the daughters of the land, what good will my life be to me?" And that concludes our introduction for this morning, right? So it's always good to have this chapter to be read for our study for today. Last night, or even the whole Saturday, yesterday, I keep on doing a summary of chapter 27, but it's too hard because all verses are so important for us to know, especially for all the people who have not heard or like have no idea what really happened before our chapter for today. And remember this? Esau said to his father, "Do you have only one blessing, my father? Bless me too, my father." Then Esau wept. I put it here because for us to remember the anger of the brother. And today, our title is The Beginning of Dreams. Man, so who among you here dream last night of something? Oh, good, you have a dream. Okay. So because our topic for today is about a dream that nobody expects, nobody really thought of. And I chose this title when I saw when Pastor Jeff gave me the teachings. I saw The Beginning of Dreams. I was excited because I thought it's Joseph the Dreamer. So when I look, what? This is not Joseph the dreamer. This is hard. But, you know, bear with me. God is good. Amen? Okay, Genesis chapter 28 and 29. Two chapters for today. We had just finished one chapter as our introduction, chapter 27. And chapter 28, 29 is one of the exciting and good for us to know what happened after Esau and Jacob, sibling rivalry. And this is like a soap opera, because just like what Pastor Jeff said last week, God's grace for a dysfunctional family. And we will know why this family is so dysfunctional. Okay, so I invite you to pray. If you could just stand up, please. Okay, amen. Almighty Father, Lord, we thank you for this morning as we come to you, Jesus, and listen to your message, O Lord God. Thank you for giving us the opportunity to be here and to have the Bible with us, to have all the access to know you more. Jesus, we love you, Lord, and override my preparation that we will see your glory. We will know you more. In Jesus' mighty name, amen. You can all sit now. So chapter 28, we have five main characters. And of course, like a movie, like a soap opera, I would like to present to you the characters of chapter 28. Isaac. Who is Isaac? Isaac is Abraham's son and husband of Rebekah. Rebekah, Isaac's wife. Isaac's wife and mother of Esau and Jacob. Esau, the firstborn of Isaac, he was a skillful hunter. Jacob, the twin brother of Esau, the brother who stole Esau's blessing. And I don't know if you see it, Laban. Can you see it? Laban, the brother of Rebekah, who lived in Haran. So the first five verses of chapter 28 is all about Jacob. So Isaac called Jacob and blessed him and commanded him, saying to him, "You shall not take a wife from the daughters of Canaan. Arise, go to Paddan Aram, to the house of Bethuel, your mother's father. And from there, take yourself a wife from the daughters of Laban, your mother's brother. May God Almighty bless you and make you fruitful and multiply you, so that you may become multitude of peoples. May he also give you the blessing of Aram to you and your descendants with you, so that you may possess the land where you live as stranger, which God gave to Abraham." Then Isaac sent Jacob away, and he went to Paddan Aram to Laban, son of Bethuel, the Aramean, the brother of Rebekah, the mother of Jacob and Esau. You know, these five verses is the journey of Isaac, of Jacob. First, Isaac and Rebekah did not want Jacob to marry a Canaanite woman. Why? Because the Canaanites worship idols and engage in other practices such as witchcraft, things that are very offensive to God. That's why they don't want their family to have a blemish, to blemish from this family, because these are wicked people. These people doesn't worship the God of Abraham and the God of Isaac. So Isaac and Rebekah instructed Jacob to go to Paddan Aram, to the house of Laban, Rebekah's brother. You know, I checked Google last night, how far is Beersheba, where they are from, to Paddan Aram. So when I check, it's like 451 miles. So when I calculated it through Google, not my mathematical expertise, because I'm not a mathematical expertise. So I checked how far Beersheba to Paddan Aram. It's like from here where you are sitting to between Montreal and Ottawa. If you walk from here to there, you will know how far Jacob walks, because during the time they just walk. And Isaac and Rebecca want to preserve the instruction of God to Abraham, to marry a woman who has the same values and beliefs that they have. A woman who will obey and make the God of Abraham and Isaac to be her God as well. Isaac blessed Jacob and asked the Lord to fulfill his promises to Abraham through Jacob and his descendants. In chapter 4. May he also give you the blessing of Abraham to you and to your descendants with you, so that you may possess the land where you live as a stranger, which God gave to Abraham. Now, they're talking about descendants here, but Abraham only have two sons, Ishmael and Isaac. How can they do that? That's why the promise, because remember, the promise to Abraham is to be the father of many nations, right? And Ishmael was kicked out of their house, so he only have one son. And Isaac's wife, Rebecca, before they know it, is also barren. Just like Sarah was barren, and then Rebecca was barren. I don't know about this family. I think they are falling in love with barren women, right? But God is good. God opened the womb of these two women, right? If God can do miracles like that, He can do miracles to your life as well. Amen? Amen. Now, let's go to the next slide. Genesis chapter 26 to 9. The first five is all about Jacob. Now, the next three is all about big brother. Esau. Can you see it? I'm sorry. You can also look there because it's better. So, God Almighty. I'm sorry. Here. Now, Esau saw that Isaac had blessed Jacob and sent him away to Padam Aram to take to himself a wife from there. And that when he blessed him, he commanded him, saying, "You shall not take a wife from the daughters of Canaan." And that Jacob had obeyed his father and his mother and had gone to Padam Aram. So Esau saw that the daughters of Canaan displeased his father Isaac. So because of anger, right? Esau already said to himself, "I'm not going to obey my father anymore, because he already gave the blessing to my brother to marry a non-Canaanite woman. What I'm going to do? I'm going to marry a Canaanite woman, because still, well, it runs in the family." And Jacob had obeyed his father and his mother and had gone to Padam Aram. So Esau saw that the daughters of Canaan displeased father Isaac. And Esau went to Ishmael. Ishmael is a brother of the son of Abraham, the brother of Isaac, and married, besides the wives that he had, Mahalat, the daughter of Ishmael, Abraham's son, the sister of Nebaioth. So Esau was already married to two Canaanite women, and then she married another woman who is the daughter of Ishmael, the brother of Isaac. So you can see Esau's rebellion attitude is so painful to Isaac, because all of this he did not command him to do, but he keep on rebelling against his father, against his father's commandment, against his father's will. Esau may be strong, he may be good in hunting, but Esau missed the point of being the eldest son. Esau missed all the blessings that supposed to be his, because he has his anger issue. He has his anger issue, and all of his decisions are right away. His decisions are all about his emotions. He decides when he's angry. He decides when he's hungry. And that's not helpful to us, especially to us, right? Amen? Remember that Isaac and Rebecca don't want their boys to marry a Canaanite woman. because of idolatry, and they have different beliefs and different values. But brother, big brother Esau doesn't care at all. He even married Mahalat, right, the daughter of Ishmael, because he thought, if my brother will marry the daughter of my uncle Laban, maybe I can also marry the daughter of my uncle, my uncle Ishmael. But no, even in the Bible, the lineage of Ishmael was not written, only the lineage of Isaac. That's why Abraham said, that's why Isaac really felt that this is really wrong. Why are you marrying the people that were not allowed to marry? You can see that Esau's decisions is so bad. Sometimes we make decisions like that. Sometimes we make decisions that we don't.
Sound check.
So sometimes we make decisions like Esau. We don't think of what will be the consequences. We only think of ourselves. We only think of our stomach. We only think of what will benefit us personally. We have to think of something that will benefit our family, that you will not hurt anybody, and what we're going to say will bless the Lord our God. Because it's important for us as believers about modeling. We go to school, we go to our work, even in the subway or the grocery store. When a person who we know, who attends church and knows that we are a believer of Christ, but we keep on saying bad words outside, and our actions are not very Christian actions, that will stumble them. Even our kids will stumble. Oh, my dad, my mom is so good at the church. They are worshiping in the church, but in the house, they worship something else. Okay, so that's why modeling is so important for us. If you said that you are a believer, you are a believer of Jesus Christ. Amen? God is good all the time. That's why it's important for us to study the Bible, because the Word of God will control our mouth, will control our emotion, will control our mind. That's why chapters 28, verses 1 to 9, I find it obedience is so important. Brothers and sisters, it's important to obey your parents. It's important to obey the Word of God. Because with obedience, it is like our love language. It's like a language that can be seen. It is important for us to obey the authorities. It's important for us to obey the people who we love, especially our parents. Our parents knows what's happening. They've been there, right? It's important to, if you have a problem, talk to some people. Talk to people. Talk to Pastor Jeff. Talk to the leaders. Talk to the people you know that love God. Talk to the people that you know that will help you spiritually. Obey is the key. Amen? Now let's move on. So the next chapter will be the same chapter, but from verses 10 to 15. Jacob's ladder. Have you heard about Jacob's ladder? Yes? You know, in the 80s, I think in the 90s, they made a Jacob's ladder. I'm sorry, I don't have the PowerPoint for that. They made a Jacob's ladder as an exercise tool. So just Google it. So you know, people always uses Bible term to sell their products. You know, iPod, you know, the tablet, right? Tablet, the iCloud, Jacob's ladder. There's so many things that they use the Bible so people will buy it. Right? Now, what is a Jacob's ladder? Here. This is just an example, Jacob's ladder. So, during his journey, Jacob went to a deep sleep. Chapter 10, verses 10 to 15. Then Jacob departed from Beersheba and went toward Haran. And he happened upon a particular place and spent the night there, because the sun had set up. And he took one of the stones of the place and made it support for his head, and lay down in that place. So he took a stone, used it as his pillow. Who among you here uses a stone as your pillow at night? No, nobody, eh? Okay. Maybe you can try and can you have a dream like Jacob. And he had a dream, and behold, a ladder was set up on the earth with its top reaching to heaven. And behold, the angels of God were ascending and descending on it. Then behold, the Lord was standing above it and said, I am the Lord, the God of your father, Abraham, and the God of Isaac. The land on which you lie, I will give to you and to your descendants. Your descendants will also be like the dust of the earth. And you will spread out to the west and to the east and to the north and to the south. And in you, in your descendants, shall all the families of the earth will be blessed. Behold, I am with you and will keep you wherever you go and will bring you back to this land, for I will not leave you until I have done what I have promised you. Then Jacob awoke from his sleep and said, the Lord is certainly in this place, and I did not know it. And he was afraid and said, how awesome is this place? This is none other than the house of God, and this is the gate of heaven. So Jacob got up early in the morning and took the stone that he had placed as a support for his head. I don't know how big that stone is. His pillow. And set it up as a memorial stone and poured oil on its top. Then he named that place Bethel, or Beetle, Bethel. But previously the name of the city had been Luz. Jacob also made a vow saying, if, now listen to this, Jacob also made a vow saying, if God will be with me and will keep me on this journey that I take and give me food to eat and garments to wear, and I return to my father's house in safety, then the Lord will be my God. And this stone, which I have set up as a memorial stone, will be God's house. And of everything that you give me, I will assuredly give a tenth to you. So, remember, from that stone, which is uncomfortable, he even poured oil. Do you pour oil on your pillow when you have dreams about God, about blessings? I don't think so, right? But Jacob, that rock, he poured oil. He anointed it. This is the first encounter of Jacob with God, written in the Bible. In 10, it said, when Jacob had a dream, he was running away from home to save his life. This is journey. He was running away from Esau because Esau is going to kill him. That's why Rebecca and Isaac told him to go to Padan Aram. So we don't know. Maybe he's really running. That's why he got tired. And then on the way, Jacob stopped for the night, resting his head on a rock. There's no other pillow that he can find. So he used the rock and fell into a deep sleep. And that night, he dreamed of a ladder stretching from earth to heaven. And so angels ascending and descending the ladder. I don't know about you if you have a dream like that. I don't. But that's really scary when you see, am I still alive? Why I'm seeing angels going up and down? Are they going to get me? Right? That's a hard dream to swallow. The Lord stood above the ladder and told Jacob that his descendants will be as many as the dust of the earth, and he will bless them. God promised to be with Jacob on his journey and to eventually bring back to Canaan. And in 18, Jacob made a pillar of stone and anointed it with oil and named the place Bethel. And in 22, that is the start of his transformation. But because Jacob was still immature in faith and still immature in believing in God, he still has a touch of his own self. He still made a condition. Remember when he said, if God will be with me and will keep me on this journey that I take, and give me food to eat and garments to wear, and I return to my father's house, then the Lord will be my God. You know, he's still skeptic about this, even though he saw a dream that no one had ever seen before. He still thinks, if God is real, if God is really there, then I will give all of you. I will give 10% to you. I will do whatever you do, you ask me to do. Brothers and sisters, do you believe that there is God? Do you believe that God is if there is God? That's the reason why we're here, because we believe in God. Amen? We believe that He is alive, and we believe that He is listening right now. He knows what we're doing. He knows the numbers of your hair. And many scholars, and even Jesus Christ said in John chapter 1, verse 51, I tell you the truth, you will all see heaven open and the angels of God going up and down on the Son of Man, the one who is the stairway between heaven and earth. Jesus made to the people known that He is the stairway to heaven. He is the only way to heaven. Just like in John 14:6, when Jesus said that I am the way, the truth, and the life. No one can come to the Father except through me. So Jesus clearly is the only way to heaven. He is the only mediator between God and man. In 1 Timothy 2:5, that's what he said, that there is only one mediator between God and man, and that is Jesus Christ. Amen? So there's no other way. There's no shortcut. There's no, maybe if I follow this, I will get to heaven. I will do this, do that. No. Only Jesus Christ is the way to heaven. Only Jesus Christ is the one that can save us. No saints, no other belief can save us. Only Jesus Christ, because He is the one who died for our sin, and He is the only mediator between God and us. What we have learned here, or what I have learned here, I will share it to you. There are three lessons that I learned from the Jacob's ladder. Number one, God can use you. Like Jacob, we all failed and stained with sin. If God only used perfect people, there wouldn't be anyone serving Him today, right? If you think you're perfect, oh, you're excused from church. You're excused. Don't sing anymore because you're perfect, right? Don't pray anymore because you're perfect. But no, all have sinned and fall short of the glory of God. Romans 3:23. May I ask who are the perfect here? None, right? That's why we need Christ. We need Jesus Christ in our lives. And number two, God has a purpose and plan for your life. We will never know God's plan and purpose if we don't study the very Word of God. That's why we have the Bible. We have the Bible app. There's so many things, there's so many gadgets, there's so many things to read for us compared to the people from the Old Testament, people from the New Testament book, right? They don't have access to what we have right now. We have the internet. We have brothers and sisters who studied the Word of God. We have elders who knows a lot more than us. We are so blessed, and we are so blessed that we are in Canada, where we can still do this Bible study. We have the church open to everybody. Because in some countries, we cannot do this. We cannot gather around and boldly declare that Jesus is Lord over all. Amen? That's why we have to embrace what we have right now. Soon, I don't know how soon, but there are movements already in the government or somewhere else that they trying to ban the gathering of Christians. They're trying to destroy Christianity. I think you can see that already in the news, YouTube, internet. But us, as long as we have breath, we will praise the Lord. Amen? And number three, God reassured us He will never leave us nor forsake us. In Hebrews chapter 13, verse 5b. For He has said, I will never leave you nor forsake you. Amen? And that ends our Genesis chapter 28. But wait, there's more. Now we're going to our next chapter, which is Genesis chapter 29. Amen. I'm sure we finish the whole Genesis today to 35, I think. No, we still have time. I'm sorry, I'm just enjoying how to talk to you right now. Genesis chapter 29. Main characters. It's like a soap opera. I'm presenting to you the main characters of this. Jacob, the son of Isaac and Rebekah, and twin brother of Esau. Laban, the brother of Rebekah who lived in Haran. Can you see this? Or here. Leah, Laban's oldest daughter. She is described as having weak eyes. I don't know about that, having weak eyes. And Rachel, the daughter of Laban, she was shepherdess of her father's flocks in Haran. By the way, can I invite all the women to stand up, please? Please, all the women, the mother, young women. Okay, amen. So you can see, you are a perfect example of how Rachel looks. She is described as beautiful in form and appearance. Amen? So we don't need to imagine what Rachel looks like. This is already the perfect example. Amen. So you can now sit down. Amen. Well, you're beautiful, right? Amen? You can. So, Genesis chapter 29, verse 1 to 16. Jacob meets Rachel. Then Jacob set out on his journey and went to the land of the people of the east. So he's already there. After that 451 miles of walk, he's already there in Padan Aram. He looked and saw a well in the field, and behold, three flocks of sheep were lying there beside it. Because they watered the flocks from that well, now the stone of the mouth of the well was large. Imagine a well. You know what a well looks like, right? When all the flocks were gathered there, the flocks, the sheep, they would roll the stone from the mouth of the well and water the sheep. Then they would put the stone back in its place on the mouth of the well. Jacob said to them, "My brothers, where are you from?" And they said, "We are from Haran." So Jacob was, "Oh, yes, I'm already here." Remember, there's no GPS during that time. So he just walked. So he's happy because he's already there. That's what his father and mother said to go to. So he said to them, "Do you know Laban, the son of Nahor?" During that time, there's no picture. How would we know that that is Laban, right? The son of Nahor. And he said, "We know him." And he said to them, "Is it well with him? And they said, "It is well. And here is his daughter Rachel coming with the sheep. So he just doesn't, he just look. Rachel is coming. Then he said, look, it is still high day, like still noon. It is not time for the livestock to be gathered. Water the sheep and go pasture them. But he said, we cannot until all the flocks are gathered. So there's a perfect timing for the well to be opened. And they rolled the stone from the mouth of the well, then we watered the sheep. So there's perfect timing to do that. It's not all the time the well is open. While he was still speaking with them, Rachel came, because remember, Rachel was still afar. Now Rachel's closer now. Rachel came with her father's sheep, for she was shepherdess. When Jacob saw Rachel, the daughter of his mother's brother Laban, he saw this beautiful girl, remember? Perfect in shape, a beautiful lady. He saw Rachel and the sheep of his mother's brother Laban. Jacob went up and rolled the stone. Remember, it's not time yet, right? But because, oh, this is beautiful. This lady is so beautiful. So maybe Jacob, you want me to open the water for you? The well. So Jacob went up and rolled the stone from the mouth of the well and watered the flock of his mother's Laban. Then, listen to this. After that, then Jacob kissed Rachel. Bah. Amazing, huh? His boys don't do this, okay? And raised his voice and wept. And like, I don't know what Jacob really looks like when he did that. Jacob told Rachel that he was a relative. Oh, by the way, I'm your relative. Of her father, and that he was Rebecca's son. And she ran and told her father. So Rachel ran to her father. Okay. So now this is the very start of the love triangle. For the boys, okay, my suggestion is don't do that to girls when you first meet up and then you kiss her right away. Don't ever do that, okay? We are in a different generation now, or else you'll be killed or you'll go to jail when you do that. Are we good at that, boys? Yeah, James, okay. Don't do that, James, huh? Don't be like daddy. Okay. So Jacob broke two rules in here, right? Just to impress this girl. By rolling the stone, that is not time yet. And number two is kissing the girl right away. In Filipino, we call it, one, pasikat, opening the thing. And number two, presko. This is not me, right? So, pasikat and presko, that's in Filipino. That's why these are the things. Now you know Jacob's attitude. First, he deceived his brother. Now, he deceived his father. Now, going to a place, being so, what's presco in English? Be fresh. Be fresh to this woman. Kiss her right away. I think that's not really a good thing. You know? So we can see Jacob already have 4 points. That is not a role model for us, right? Do not do those things. Now it's already 4. Remember when the Bible described Rachel, she was beautiful and has nice figure. Maybe that's the reason why he did that. And Rachel looks exactly the women of this church. Beautiful and has nice figure. Amen? Oh, amen. See, ladies, amen? Amen. How about the husband? Amen for that? Amen. Amen. Okay, so let's move on to 29:13-16. So when Laban heard the news about Jacob, his sister's son, he ran to meet him and embraced him and kissed him and brought him to his house. Then he told Laban all these things. And Laban said to him, you certainly are my bone and flesh. Good old uncle, right? And he stayed with him
a month.
Then Laban said to Jacob, because you are my relative, should you therefore serve me for nothing? Tell me, what shall wages be? Oh, so very nice uncle. I think because you're working for me, I need to pay you. Not because your relatives. No, it's not free. You're not working for free. I need to pay you. Just ask me. That's what Laban. What a nice uncle, right? I think Laban is one of the nicest uncle in the Bible. So far. So far. Now, Laban had two daughters. Remember what we mentioned earlier. The name of the older was Leah, and the name of the younger was Rachel. And Leah's eyes are weak, but Rachel was beautiful in figure and appearance. Now Jacob loved Rachel. It's love at first sight, because when he saw Rachel, he fell in love right away. So he said, I will serve you 7 years for your younger daughter, Rachel. Remember, these are not the terms of Laban. These are the terms of Jacob. Laban said, it is better that I give her to you than to give her to another man. Stay with me. What a very nice uncle so far, right? So Jacob served 7 years for Rachel. And they seemed to him like only a few days because of his love for her. Because, of course, he see Rachel every day for 7 years. Maybe whenever Jacob worked for Laban, he always like fresco. Hey, hi, Rachel. Like, I'm doing this for you because for 7 years, you will be my wife. Don't worry. Time flies so fast. Now, things are getting exciting, right, for Jacob. He's so motivated that there's an assurance that his beloved uncle, who is so nice, is going to give him Rachel as his salary for 7 years. And that is going to work for him. And if I ask now the gentleman, are you willing to wait 7 years to get the woman of your dream? Oh, wow. Our young men are really into it. Amen. 7 years. Do not rush, okay? So Jacob worked 7 years for Rachel. So Laban welcomed Jacob into his home and stayed a month, realizing Jacob intend to stay for him. Sometimes Laban asked him, right? So it is just all Jacob's condition. Jacob had fallen in love with Laban's younger daughter, Rachel, and asked 7 years in exchange of marriage. So Jacob served 7 years for Rachel. And it seemed like, just like what I mentioned earlier, it seems like 2 days only for him because he was so inspired. Just like whenever we see our wife, we're so inspired, right? Men, right? Every time we see them, we're so inspired. Like it, Evet, we're so inspired seeing our wife, right? Amen. 100%. Amen. So now, the big day come. Laban's treachery, the big day. Love it. Then Jacob said to Laban, give me my wife, for my time is completed. Already 7 years, that I may have relations with her. So Laban gathered all the people. Remember that 7 years, the Bible didn't say anything about Laban's attitude to Jacob, right? That he was a bad uncle or things like this. They did not fight. So Laban gathered all the peoples of the place and held a feast. So a very nice uncle. He had a massive feast because it's a wedding of his daughter and Jacob. Now in the evening, he took his daughter Leah and brought her to him. And Jacob had relations with her. So Laban brought Leah. And it's a wedding. So we don't know what Leah was wearing that night. So maybe a thick veil, a nice dress that even Jacob didn't notice. Laban also gave his female slave Zilpah to his daughter Leah as a slave. So it came about in the morning. So the night, the feast. So it came about in the morning that, behold, it was Leah. And he said to Laban, "What is this that you have done to me? Was it not for Rachel that I served with you? Why then you have deceived me?" So I maybe when he woke up that morning, bed, he saw it's a different lady. This is not Rachel. This is Leah. So remember Jacob when he deceived his father, right? He deceived his father that he was Esau. Now, those of his own medicine, it happened to him in a matter of like 7 years. I've waited for 7 years. I worked for you 7 years. We didn't have any argument. We didn't have any trouble. I'm here. I'm here that I love your daughter, and you know that your daughter is my price, my salary, and it's my term. But Laban said, "Oh, I forgot. It is not the practice in our place to marry off the younger before the firstborn." Okay. Complete the week of this one. So another 7 days. So another, just 7 days. Just 7 days. 7 days, right? So I said, so Jacob, 7 days, that's nothing. "And we will give you the other also for the service, which you shall serve with me for another 7 years. What? So, but because Jacob loved Rachel so much, Jacob did so and completed her week and gave him his daughter Rachel as his wife. Laban also gave his female slave Bilhah to his daughter, Rachel as her slave. So Jacob had relations with Rachel also, and indeed he loved Rachel more than Leah, and he served with Laban for another 7 years. You know, earlier, in verse 23, Jacob may be drunk that he didn't notice that Leah was the one given to him. He did not recognize Leah that night. So it looks like Jacob is the one who has weak eyes in here, not Leah. So Jacob was in the shock of a lifetime when he woke up. And Laban, we learn in verse 26, is a bigger joker than Jacob. It's a bigger deceiver than Jacob. And he worked for another 7 years and 7 days. Now, the Lord saw that Leah was unloved. He opened her womb. So he opened her womb. Does it mean that Leah is also barren? Maybe, right? But Rachel was unable to have children. Now, again, this dysfunctional family are falling in love with barren women. From Abraham, Sarah was barren. Rebecca was barren. Now Rachel was barren. All barren, but God promised for them is God promised for Abraham is to be the father of many nations. That's why Sarah had a baby. Rebecca had a baby. And Rachel, who is still barren at this time. Now Leah conceived and gave birth to a son and named him Reuben. For she said, "Because the Lord has seen my affliction, surely now my husband will love me." So we can see that Jacob still not in love with her, and they had a son already. Then she conceived again and gave birth to a son, so son number two, and said, "Because the Lord has heard that I am unloved, he has therefore given me this son also." So she named him Simeon. 34. And she conceived again and gave birth to a son and said, "Now this time my husband will become attached to me because I have borne him three sons." Therefore, he was named Levi. And she conceived again and gave birth to a son and said, this time, I will praise the Lord. Therefore, she named him Judah. Then she stopped having child. You know, Leah already have 4 sons, but still, she cannot feel the love from Jacob. Leah only feels the love from her sons, not from the husband who gave her 4 sons. You know, God works in mysterious ways that we cannot understand. For his ways are higher than our ways, and his thoughts are higher than our thoughts. And from the last verse that we just read, you know, we see the contentment of Leah here. That even if she doesn't feel the love, she still praises the Lord. Right? Because she knows that God loves her so much. And to end our message for today, you know, this is how God loves us so much. Leah showed us an example that no matter what happened, if you feel alone, sad, depressed, sick, and if you think that the world is against you, God is always there. Amen? God loves us so much that He gave us only begotten Son, that whosoever believe in Him shall not perish but have everlasting life. In John 3:16. And, you know, to end our message for today, there is a song that I love. I heard it when I was like maybe 7, 5, or 10 years old. It was a song from Joseph the Dreamer. The title of this is, He Will Carry You. And let this song be a reminder for us that God loves us in all circumstances. God will always love us, no matter who you are. God is always there for us. And let this song be a prayer for all of you, for all of us. And I would like to call Brother Willie to offer this song for us. To God be all the glory.